Thank you everyone. So I would like to thank our esteemed all the faculties who have been really who have been really helpful for joining this meeting, who have spared their valuable time today, as well as I would like to thank our sponsors for today's session, starting from the Roche, AstraZeneca, as well as the BMS, who has helped us in starting this this particular platform and the webinar. So at the beginning, because we know that now the lung and the head and neck cancer, the outcomes of both these cancers has been really evolving over the time period. And we have seen in the case of the lung cancer, how the survival has greatly improved. And now these changes are we are able to see with the head and neck cancer with the introduction of various novel therapies, including the immunotherapy as well. So initial talk will be, I would like to talk on the first topic. It would be the optimizing the treatment in the relapse refractory and the metastatic squamous cell head and neck carcinoma with the immune checkpoint inhibitors. Ravindra, can I share the slides?
Yes, sir, you can share the slide. You have all the access. So your screen is visible. Please open the slide and
yes. So as we know that this squamous cell head and neck carcinomas, they have a significant impact on the quality of
life. Dr. Suhas, sorry for interrupting. Yes. Sir, we are not able to see your slides, sir.
Okay, so.
Can you please reshare your screen? Just stop your screen and reshare it.
Now, is it visible?
No, sir.
No,
not yet, sir. So just I would make you stop sharing. Just a minute, sir. So now you can share again, sir, your screen.
Is it visible now?
Yes, sir, your slides are visible. Put it on presenter mode, sir. It is visible now.
Is it visible now?
Perfect, sir. Perfect. Very much.
Thanks. So as we know that the squamous cell head and neck cancers, they are having a significant impact on the patient quality of the life. As such, due to the damage to the anatomical structure, which are involved in the speech, swallowing, or the breathing, maybe because of the tumor or because of the surgical or the chemo and the radiation treatment related effects, there are quite significant impact on the patient quality of the life. Secondly, this leads to the alteration in the physical functions, maybe the physical appearance as well as the social interactions, which are common in this group of the patient. And thirdly, what we can ultimately say that this disease is having a greater psychological distress than many of the cancer what we see in the day-to-day clinical practice. Ultimately, because maybe the treatment-related facial disfigurement, maybe due to the impairment of the speech, eating, breathing, as well as the drinking. So second thing would be, as we know that there is a huge unmet need in the management of the head and neck cancer patients, it would require a multidisciplinary care along with the patients to optimize the maximum outcomes. So as we know that this is a multidisciplinary tumor approach involving the various fields of the treatments. And as we know that this management is a very complex one, it would need the full range of the support services and the specialist in order to maximize the outcome. And we definitely see those centers who are having a high volume of the patient, they are likely to give the better outcome as compared to the others. So as we see, this head and neck constitutes the most common cancer in India, as we see from the recent GlobalCon 2018 data, and it consists of almost about the 20% of the total tumor burden. Secondly, because there is risk of almost 50% of the patient relapsing within the 2 years, majority in the clinical practice, we see the patient being diagnosed in advanced stages, say stage 3 or 4. Very few patients, less than 30 or 40%, they are being diagnosed at an early stages. And more so, almost about the 50% of the patient, they are likely to relapse within a period of 2 years. As we see, the outcomes will be poorer as we move from the early to the advanced stage tumors. So as we know that this platinum-based therapy, it is a most important aspect of the management in the locally advanced head and neck cancer patients, with cisplatin being the core of the treatment, either in the neoadjuvant or maybe in the concurrent settings. Apart from that, so despite all these available measures, the outcomes remain poor, particularly for those patients who progresses on this platinum-based treatment. So the core of the squamous cell head and neck would be the basic biology, which is considered as one of the quite profound immunosuppression tumor, which is having a profound immunosuppression. And there are various phases of immune modulation which goes on in the tumor microenvironment. What we commonly see is that there is a decrease in the absolute T cell count in the tumor as well as in the circulation, and there would be the apoptotic features leading to the defective functioning also. The regulatory T cell, which are responsible for forming an immunosuppressive barrier and which they will hinder the activity of the effector T cell in the tumor microenvironment, and also they will interfere with the anti-tumor responses to the immunotherapy. The decrease, so overall it is because of the decrease in the total immune cells with the antigen presenting machinery, like maybe the dendritic T cell or the NK T cell, which confers a profound immunosuppressed state. Normally now with this availability of the newer immune checkpoint inhibitor, particularly with the OPDATA, which is an IgG4 PD-1 receptor blocking monoclonal antibodies, and it will have a direct impact at the tumor site to prevent the inactivation and the reactivation of the T cell to attack the tumor. So now we will be seeing the CheckMate 141 updates for this particular, and now recently 2 year update from the CheckMate 141 has been released, and which has shown that the nivolumab as compared to the investigator choice drug in case of the recurrent or metastatic squamous cell carcinoma is having a superior outcomes. So this was a study which was a randomized phase 3 trial in the patient who had progressed on or within the 6 months of the platinum based therapies, and they had a ECOG of 0 to 1, and it was irrespective of the PD-L1 status. Normally with the OPDATA 3 mg/kg every 2 weekly versus the investigator choice like methotrexate, docetaxel or cetuximab. The primary endpoint was overall survival, while the other endpoints were PFS, overall response rate and the safety analysis. We can see all the baseline characteristics were evenly balanced, and this data was relevant catering the all the subgroups of the patients, involving the like quality of the life, prior cetuximab use, HPV status, as well as the response rate, and even the Asian subset was also included. What was most important thing was the overall survival, and we can see from this figure that at the 2 years, the overall survival was more, almost 3 times as compared to the control arm, with 32% reduction in the risk of the death. So apart from the survival benefit, it showed a durable responses to the treatment. So OPDATA, as we have seen earlier with the survival, it showed a durable of responses of 4 versus almost more than doubling of the duration of the responses, and median time to response was even equally balanced between the investigator choice drug and the Opdivo, that was almost 2 months around. So this was again the OS benefit in this group, in this trial. Basically, the both PD-L1 and the PD-L1 negative status were included. As we can see from this figure, both these population were benefited, but the benefit was maximum or more with this PD-L1 positive patients. So there was a reduction in the risk of death by almost 45% as compared to 27% in case of PD-L1 negative patients. So we can see in this trial, all the patient subgroups were included who have progressed directly on the platinum therapy, to include the Opdivo in the first line setting. Maybe those patients who have progressed on the platinum in the first line, then as a second line, or maybe the Opdivo even in the third line setting also. So outcomes. So most important thing was that the earlier use of the Opdivo was associated with the improvement in the survival benefit. Most of the patient, like almost 21% of the patient, they received Opdivo in the first line setting when the patient has received the platinum therapy in the primary or the adjuvant setting. So when it was used in the early setting, the survival benefit was almost more than 5 times, with almost 46% reduction in the risk of death at 2 years. It was 4 versus 21.6% improvement in the survival. So this was a subgroup analysis which demonstrated again the overall response rate of almost 20% overall response rate in case of the Opdivo arm. And the time to median time to response was 2 months, which was more or less similar in case of both these arms. So it also improved the quality of life related measures in a patient. Basically, when we see there is a very clinically hampering, very clinical deterioration in the patient with the diagnosis or with the treatment or with the further use of the various treatment options. Even there was improvement in the symptom burden, and these were the various symptom burden. But important thing was that overall it was 88% reduction in the risk of death when this drug has been able to achieve either a complete or the partial remission in the patient who have these kind of responses. And this median overall survival was not reached in this particular subset versus 13.6 months in case of the control arm. So this was a very important thing, that once the patient is able to achieve either a partial or a complete remission, they are likely to have a longer survival as compared to the other treatment modalities. Similarly, those patients, normally what we see in the clinical practice, that stable disease, we are not much happy with the achieving a stable disease, but this trial has shown that once the patient, even they will achieve a stable disease, they are likely to survive longer as compared to the others. So this was particularly with the cetuximab use. Both these, we can see the cetuximab, whether there was a previous exposure or not. And this study has shown that these agent will be particularly beneficial when there is no previous cetuximab exposure to the patient. And even there was improvement in the OS irrespective of the age. Similarly, this was an important slide which has shown the benefit of the Opdivo in both HPV positive as well as negative patient. Normally, what we see is that HPV negative are considered as a poor prognosis as compared to the HPV positive patient. But what we can infer from this slide is that even though the patient with HPV negative, they have benefited in the same way as that of the HPV positive patient. So it gives us an upper edge with the Opdivo use, particularly in this prognostically poor patient, where we can think that maybe this unmet need of the poor prognostic outcome has been met with the use of the Opdivo. This was again with the Asian subset population. We can see the outcomes were slightly better in the Asian as compared to the intention to treat population, while the reduction in the risk of death was almost 60% in the Asian versus 32% in case of intention to treat population. So this was a favorable toxicity profile. As we know, these are very easily manageable drug in the clinical practice. At 2 years, the rate of discontinuation was 50% as compared to the standard of the as compared to the investigator choice. And even with the at 2 years, the grade 3-4 adverse event were very less as compared to the investigator choice. So these are the major side effect profile. Mainly the grade 3-4 adverse event were very less, and mainly it was a fatigue, maybe the asthenia or the anemia in the Opdita arm. So what would be important is that starting the patient as early as possible as a preferred monotherapy, or when the patient has progressed on the platinum based treatment, that is going to help us in the maximum possible ways. So this normally with this study, the treatment evaluation after starting, first evaluation was done at 9 weeks and subsequently with the 6 weeks. But I don't think it would be really feasible in the clinical practice per se. So to conclude, these cancer have a major, not only the physical, but also physiological, social, and the psychological impact. Multidisciplinary tumor approaches will be helpful to provide optimal solution for the patient. This Opdita has shown a survival benefit in the platinum exposed relapse refractory or the metastatic head and neck cancer patient, and magnitude of median OS benefit was more than 5 times as compared to the other standard of the care in the first line subgroup. While it showed improvement in the quality of life measures or maybe the stabilization of the measures, and particularly with the Asian subgroup, and it was demonstrated 60% reduction in the risk of death. Particularly, I would like to again focus with the HPV status and the PD-L1, the benefits were irrespective of the PD-L1 status. Thank you. So now I would like to call upon the next speaker, Dr. Pritam Kataria, who is a consultant medical oncologist at HN Reliance Hospital, for his talk on the newer updates in the first line extensive stage squamous small cell lung carcinoma.
Good evening. I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. Are my slides visible?
Yes, sir.
Visible. And audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Suhas bhai. I just for a wonderful talk. So I'll be speaking on the IO updates, first line, extensive stage, SCLC. So as we all know, the small cell lung cancer accounts for 13% of all the lung cancers. And, we all know that the clinical presentation in this SCLC could be local, having symptoms like cough, dyspnea, or there could be symptoms because of the distance metastasis, and it could present with the paraneoplastic syndromes, as I mentioned in the slide. Now, the SCLC diagnosis and staging, we know that the staging of SCLC is as per the Veterans Administration Lung Staging Group, and it is divided into limited stage and extensive stage. And here I will be speaking about the treatment of the extensive stage with respect to the immunotherapy. The systemic therapy in the small cell lung cancer has evolved right from 1970s, where we started with the alkylator-based chemotherapy, to 1980s with anthracycline-based chemotherapies. And in 1990s, we started with the EP combination, that is the platinum etoposide combination. And today we are looking at the checkpoint inhibitors. And it has been a long way in the treatment of the small cell lung cancer. And why the progress has been slow? Because there is absence of any driver mutation in SCLC. Unlike in NSCLC, especially adenocarcinoma, where we have EGFR, ALK, ROS, MET. So what is the role of immunotherapy in SCLC that we are going to look at? SCLC has a high tumor mutational burden, and that comes to our rescue when we are talking about immunotherapy in SCLC. Though the PD-L1 expression is low as compared to NSCLC in small cell lung cancer, the tumor mutational burden has been high. And we look at both the markers, either PD-L1 or tumor mutational burden, when we are planning for immunotherapy in other tumor groups. So mutational burden is associated with improved efficacy of immune checkpoint inhibitors in patients, especially which has been shown in melanoma and other cancers. And we use the same principle in patients with small cell lung cancer. Now, this just to give an overview, if there was a study which looked at what was the expression of PD-L1 in SCLC patients, and what was seen was there was no PD-L1 expression in especially 94 patients which they looked at by IIC. But there was PD-L1 expression in tumor-infiltrated macrophages, and there was a PD-1 expression on the T lymphocytes. So by this, we can understand the PD-L1 expression is very low in NSCLC as compared in SCLC as compared to NSCLC. And PD-L1 expression is associated with improvement in survival. Those patients who have a PD-L1 expression in SCLC will have improvement in the overall survival, which can be seen from this graph. Now, as I said, the PD-L1 expression or prevalence is lower in SCLC as compared to NSCLC, and this is how, which can be seen from this. So this is an overview of the different published literature of immune checkpoint inhibitors in SCLC, right? From 2015, it has been started till now recently. There is IM power study, atezolizumab plus chemotherapy, CheckMate 451 nivo plus CP, CheckMate 331 nivo lumab monotherapy. So what is the rationale to combine the immune checkpoint inhibitors with chemotherapy in SCLC? Chemotherapy induces tumor cell killing, which leads to the tumor antigen release and which exposes it to the immune system, and the immune system gets activated. Now, PD-L1 overexpression leads to an immune cell inhibition and T cell inhibition. So the PD-1 and the PD-L1 inhibition restore the tumor-specific T cell immunity, and the reversal of immune suppression leads to deeper and more durable responses with systemic anti-tumor therapy. So this is a complementary effect when we combine chemotherapy along with the immunotherapy. Now, coming to the landmark study, that is the IMpower 133 study, which looked at the combination of IO, that is atezolizumab plus chemotherapy, for the advanced SCLC group. So this was the concern diagram. What we can see is atezolizumab was combined with chemotherapy versus placebo plus chemotherapy. The primary endpoints were overall survival and progression-free survival, while the secondary endpoints were overall response rate, duration of response, and safety. Now, these patients, after receiving 4 cycles, were put on maintenance, that is atezolizumab versus the placebo. What we can see is, from this Kaplan-Meier analysis, that the median progression-free survival was 5.2 months in those patients who received the immunotherapy along with chemotherapy versus 4.3 months in the placebo plus chemotherapy arm. And it was statistically significant. What we can see is, the 6-month progression-free survival was 30.9 months versus 22.4 months, but the 12 months progression-free survival was 12.6 months versus 5.4 months. And at the end of around 20 to 21 months, the two graphs seems to be separating. If we look at the overall survival, what we can see is the overall survival in the immunotherapy arm was 12.3 months versus 10.3 months in those patients who had received only chemotherapy. And what we can see is at the 12 months, the overall survival was 51.7 months percent versus 38.2%. If you look at this for a chart in the subgroup analysis, what we can see is except those patients who had brain metastasis, all other subgroups favored the atezolizumab arm. If you look at the adverse event, the grade 3, grade 4 adverse events were not much more in the immunotherapy plus chemotherapy arm versus the chemotherapy arm, and the other side effects or the other adverse events were tolerable, and they were not overt as compared to only chemotherapy. So based on this data, that is the IMpower 133, atezolizumab plus chemotherapy was approved by FDA in 2019 for the first line treatment of extensive stage SCLC. Now coming to the second trial, that is the KEYNOTE-604 study, which looked at the combination of pembrolizumab plus chemotherapy versus placebo plus chemotherapy. And these patients were put on maintenance, that is pembrolizumab versus placebo. This was the baseline characteristics of the patients in both arms. And if you look at the interim analysis, that is the progression-free survival, what we can see is it was 4.5 months versus 4.3 months. The p-value was significant. And if you look at the final analysis, it was 4.8 months versus 4.3 months. If you look at the, in the final analysis, the progression-free survival at 18 months was 10.8% versus 2.1%. If you look at the overall survival, what we can see is in the intention to treat population, the median overall survival was 10.8 months versus 9.7 months, but the p-value was not significant. If you look at the subgroup analysis, what we can see is the, if you look at the PFS subgroup analysis, it favored the pembro with chemotherapy arm. And if you look at the overall survival in majority of the subgroups, it favored the pembro plus the chemotherapy arm. If you look at the overall response rate, the overall response rate in the pembro plus chemotherapy arm was 70.6% versus 61.8% in the placebo plus chemotherapy arm. If you look at the duration of response at 18, it was the pembro plus EP was 4.2 months versus 3.7 months. At 18 months, 16.3% patients had the duration of response was seen in 16.3% population versus 1.3% population in the placebo arm. If you look at the adverse events, again, they were comparable and there were not overt side effects in the immunotherapy plus chemotherapy combination arm. If you look at the immune mediated adverse event, as expected, they were more in the immunotherapy arm. And the grade 3, grade 4 immune mediated adverse events were 7.2% versus 1.3% in the chemotherapy alone arm. So addition of pembrolizumab to chemotherapy led to improvement in the progression-free survival. However, the improvement of the OS with the addition of pembrolizumab did not reach the statistical significance. And the durable responses were seen in approximately 20% of the patients. Now coming to the third study, that the Caspian study, which was again a multicentric phase 3 study, which looked at the three arms, that is the durvalumab plus tremelumab plus chemotherapy versus durvalumab plus chemotherapy versus chemotherapy alone. And these were the baseline characteristics of the patients. What we can see is the median overall survival between the durvalumab plus tremelumab combination was 10.4 months versus 10.5 months in the chemotherapy alone. So it was not statistically significant. If you look at the subgroup analysis again, though what we can see is the subgroup analysis favored the combination of durvalumab plus tremelumab as compared to chemotherapy. The PFS, if you look at the PFS data, what we can see is the median PFS was 4.9 months versus 5.4 months. And the duration of response was 5.2 months versus 5.1 month. If you look at the overall survival, what we can see is the overall survival was 12 in the durvalumab plus EP versus EP alone arm. The durvalumab plus chemotherapy arm had a median overall survival of 12.9 months versus 10.5 months in the chemotherapy alone arm, and it was statistically significant. What we can see is at the end of 2 years, the overall survival was 22.2% in the immunotherapy plus chemotherapy arm versus 14.4% in the chemotherapy alone arm. If you look at the subgroup analysis, again, the subgroup analysis favored the addition of durvalumab to chemotherapy versus chemotherapy alone. If you look at the median PFS, what we can see is the median PFS was 5.1 months in the durvalumab plus chemotherapy arm versus 5.4 in the chemotherapy alone arm. However, the, if you look at the landmark PFS at the end of 18 months and 24 months, it was significant in those patients who had received durvalumab plus chemotherapy versus chemotherapy alone arm, especially at the end of 24 months, it is 11% versus 2.9% in the chemotherapy alone arm. If you look at the overall response rate for the durvalumab plus chemotherapy, what we can see is it was around 67.9% versus 58% in the chemotherapy alone arm. If you look at the overall survival in all arms, what we can see is the durvalumab plus chemotherapy did better as compared to durvalumab plus tremelumab plus chemotherapy versus chemotherapy alone. And if you look at the safety profile, this was a safety profile of the patients. So first line durvalumab plus EP demonstrated improvement in the overall survival. However, the addition of tremelumab to durvalumab did not have any significant benefit. Now, ipilimumab plus chemotherapy versus chemotherapy in previously untreated extensive SCLC, this was a randomized phase 2 study. which looked at ipilimumab plus chemotherapy versus ipilimumab plus chemotherapy in a phased manner versus placebo plus chemotherapy. And these patients were put on maintenance. This was in the concurrent versus the phased manner. This was the overall survival. And this was the hazard ratio for the overall survival in the concurrent ipilimumab arm versus a phased ipilimumab arm. Now, what we can see is the median overall survival in those patients who received ipilimumab plus chemotherapy was 11 months versus 10.9 months in the placebo plus chemotherapy arm. So, again, showing that there was not much benefit and it was not statistically significant, showing that the addition of ipilimumab plus chemotherapy did not have any statistical benefit. Now, coming to the maintenance treatment, that is, this was the first trial which looked at the pembrolizumab maintenance. And it showed that it has a very limited benefit in those patients who have received chemotherapy and required a maintenance. The pembrolizumab was used in this trial. And what we can see is the median progression-free survival was just 1.4 months. Then this is a second trial which looked at the maintenance therapy after the patient had received four cycles of chemotherapy. There's a nevo plus EP, nevo alone, and the placebo. And these are the baseline characteristics of the patient. The overall survival in those patients who received nevo plus EP was 9.2 months versus 9.6 months in the placebo arm, and it was not statistically significant. What we can see is only those patients who received nivolumab maintenance versus placebo, again, the median overall survival was not statistically significant. And this was a progression-free survival, again, showing that there was no benefit of adding nevo plus EP as a maintenance or nevo as a maintenance in those patients who have received previous chemotherapy as a maintenance treatment as compared to placebo. Now, these patients were randomized into two groups. Those patients who received this treatment less than 5 weeks after the completion of chemotherapy versus those patients who received this treatment more than 5 weeks after the completion of chemotherapy. Now, those patients who received this treatment less than 5 weeks after the completion of chemotherapy, the median overall survival, benefit showed a benefit in terms of nivo plus EP or nivo as compared to placebo. However, those patients who were randomized more than 5 weeks after did not show any benefit. So these are the ongoing trials of immunotherapy in SCLC, and hopefully we would have more and more data for using immunotherapy in SCLC patients. So IO holds an important treatment modality arm in the terms of the treatment of the SCLC, and IO with chemotherapy is an acceptable modality, especially combination of immunotherapy with chemotherapy, especially pembro and atezolizumab, have shown improvement in the PFS and OS. Addition of tremelimumab to durvalumab did not show any benefit. Nevo plus EP combination or nevo alone did not show any benefit as a maintenance therapy in those patients who were randomized more than 5 weeks after completion of chemotherapy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Preetha, for the nice discussion. Now I would like to invite Dr. Tejinder Singh, who is a consultant medical oncologist at Apollo Hospital, New Mumbai, for the next case-based panel discussion. And the topic is management of the stage 3 non-small cell lung carcinoma. Dr. Tejinder Singh.
Thank you. Thank you, Suhas. And, thank Dr. you, Deshpande, sir. So I'll invite my panelists, Dr. Deshpande, sir, Dr. Sanjay Sharma, sir. Sanjay Sharma, sir, I think I'm not able to see it over here.
Ha, sir.
Dr. Bakshi, sir. Dr. Priya, Dr. Bhavin. Bhavin also, I'm not able to see over here. Dr. Dipali. Dr.
Bhavin has joined, sir.
Okay, great. And Dipali is there. I'm able to see her. And Dr. Tonse. Dr. Tonse is also there.
Sir, so, Dr. Deshpande won't be able to join because of some of the technical issues.
So, any surgeons here in the list?
Dr. Priya is there, sir.
Dr. Priya is there, right.
Yes.
So we need a surgeon because, stage 3 goes to surgeon most of the time. So this will be I'll be putting up more of a case-based discussion, also direct question and answer in order to understand the stage 3 disease, because we know stage 3 disease is a very heterogeneous disease. So coming to the case, it's a case of March 2018, diagnosed, presented with weight loss and cough, and x-ray showed a radio opacity in the left upper and middle lobe of left lung. Also, there was variational haziness around. So this is a CT scan finding which showed large heterogeneously enhancing lesion with the necrotic component involving the AP segment of the left upper lobe, suggestive of neoplastic lesion. Also, there were few subcentimetric and enlarged mediastinal nodes representing a metastatic disease. A small nodule was also seen along the right lower lobe, which may represent, could be a metastatic or post-infectious thing. This is how the PET CT looks like. A big mass, you know, you can see 7.6 by 7.5 by 8.3 in the left upper lobe. You can see a big mass, and which was aborting the, you know, the pleura also, mediastinal and costal pleura. And the mass was aborting the arch of aorta and circling the left upper lobe bronchus with mediastinal nodes on the right side. That means it is a disease which is not only restricted to the left side, it was also on the right side. So the biopsy showed poorly differentiated adenocarcinoma, TTF positive. And the final diagnosis is your adenocarcinoma left lung, T4N3M0, because the size is more than 7 centimeter. N3 because of the other side mediastinal node involvement. Now, Bhavin, I have one small question. You think this patient requires a surgical opinion, or it is a totally a ball game for the chemo radiation? Bhavin is there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, N3 disease, but the understanding with respect to stage 3 lung cancer is that if it is resectable and surgeon can resect it out, it should be resected. Surgery should be the primary modality of treatment, but most of the time N3 disease, surgery is difficult or surgery is not possible. So N3 disease, people tend to give chemo radiation upfront.
Okay, so you will still take an opinion from a radiation from the surgical oncologist.
Yes, I will still take an opinion from the multidisciplinary. I will ask all my colleagues, surgeon, medical oncologist, if there is anything else that can be done apart from CTRT. Take a decision in the multidisciplinary clinic and then start with the treatment.
So one more question to Dr. Priya is there. You're the only surgeon here. So here, what will be, I will discuss about the multidisciplinary thing, but you think this patient basically should go directly for chemo radiation or should come first to you?
Sir, I would just like to complete the metastatic profile by doing a MRI brain, because it's quite a big tumor with 3C. So first I would do a MRI brain, then I would do a EBUS or a mediastinoscopy to confirm whether it is an N3 or not.
Great.
And if it is N3, I would send the patient for CTRT, because 3C which basically N3 wouldn't come in the surgical profile upfront. Maybe later on if something like a salvage surgery we can think of, fine. But otherwise, as per guidelines, N3 will go for CTRT. So intent would still be curative because it is still 3C, not 4.
So even this patient has got a PET scan which is showing the uptake on the opposite side, you will still go for mediastinoscopy.
India has an endemic tuberculosis, sir. So it's difficult that left side he doesn't have many nodes, but right side he's got such so many nodes. So better is to have pathological confirmation, as that will change the management completely. If it's N2, I would give neoadjuvant and do a surgery for it.
So in all patients, in spite of the PET scan finding, you are still doing a mediastinoscopy or only for selective patients?
No, sir. So there is a difference between a practical answer and a theoretical answer. If I go for a practical answer, I would say no, because India, we can't afford to do a mediastinoscopy or of EBUS for all patients.
No, I am very practical. I am very practical here.
Yeah. So here for this patient, I would, sir, because it's an obvious N3. And if it's an N3, he will not come up for surgery. He'll go for CTRT. So okay. I would definitely want to confirm this. Make sure it's an N3 before I, sentence the patient to CTRT rather than a surgical option.
Fine. So, Dr. Bakshi, sir, how many times, like in these cases, you, and actually we don't say anything to the surgeon, but you prefer doing a mediastinoscopy in this kind of patient, or you will directly send EBUS. Okay. So, Dr. Bakshi,
sir. Yeah. So, one second. So, actually, increasingly, we are... sorry for that. So, increasingly, we are... extremely sorry.
Yeah.
We are using EBUS in such patients to really stage them, and I agree completely with what Dr. Isha has said. I think considering the infection that we encounter in our country, in all such patients, we have to properly stage the patient with the EBUS.
Right. And what will be here, the intent will be purely curative, right? Even though it's
so, yeah, still, we would be treating with a curative intent, but actually, this patient is a stage 3C, not a 3A or B. So, I think the prognosis will still be a little bit guarded, but yes, of course, we would treat them with a curative intent and would treat it with chemo radiation.
So, one more question is that now the biopsy was done. Will you do a biomarkers, molecular markers, or you will not do a molecular marker in this case?
I would do. So, I would... I would send for PD-L1 testing also, and I would test the patient for mutations also.
Okay. Okay. That's very important, because I think the two points which were highlighted by Dr. Bhavin was that, you know, these are the cases which needs to be discussed in the multidisciplinary team. Every institute has got a tumor board which they discuss in the MDT, and these decisions need to be taken jointly. I think very important point Priya told, that in spite of having a patient on a very good uptake on the other side of the medicine, ideally we should do EBUS. Now the facility for EBUS is quite easy nowadays. You have many people who do it. And it's Priya, I think mediastinoscopy after the EBUS has come has gone down.
Yes, sir, it has gone down significantly, but it is still has an importance where you are not able to access it, or if you are still suspecting strongly and it's a negative EBUS. But yes, I agree, it has come down drastically as the learning curve for the EBUS also is going through now.
Yeah, because, you know, I think EBUS has the way we are sitting in cities, that's the main reason why, you know, for us it becomes very easy for the. There are many trained people who can do EBUS. That's the reason, right? Right?
Yes, sir.
Your practice might be now commonly involving people for the EBUS, right?
Absolutely, sir.
Okay. So, I think what Dr. Priya told is very right. You know, these are the patients who are ideal candidates for doing an EBUS. EBUS is very easily available. Most of the centers they have got. So, I think we should be able to think about it. Bhavin is also right. You know, most of this patient ultimately being N3 disease, this needs to be discussed in a multidisciplinary board, and ultimately most of these patients, they ultimately will land up for chemo radiation. And this is just a key take-home message from this small thing, that MDT approach is the one which leads on to best outcome in the stage 3 disease. And the question, important thing is for the, it's a curative intent disease. Now, again, a question to Priya. I think you will have a lot of questions in the initial slide. When you talk about the decision, naturally they will be asked about the N1 disease, N2 disease. How do you pick up this thing, management of N1 and N2 disease? These are the surgical areas, right? N1 and N2. Right, there are some areas where N2, we will discuss about going for induction chemotherapy.
Fair enough, sir. Yeah. So if the N1 patient has a T of more than 4 cm, otherwise fit patient, I would give NACT and then go for surgery definitely. If the size is less than 4 cm with N1, I would go for upfront surgery, lobectomy with the systematic mediastinal lymph node dissection. If it's an N2 disease, I would again see the N2, whether it's a single N2, sir, or it's a multiple station bulky N2. Because I would still go for surgery. There are a lot of people definitely who say that bulky multi-station N2 does not do well with surgery now, but I still think that no, it does help. So what we have seen is that if it's an N2, definitely NACT followed by surgery, followed by adjuvant chemo or chemo plus radiation, depending on the histopaths.
So this, what you told about the T4 disease.
Not T4, sir, 4 cm. If it's a fit patient, if I would say that I have kept to choose only one therapy, I would first go ahead for surgery. If it's a clear-cut lobectomy, get the tumor out and then give the patient adjuvant therapy as applicable. But if the patient can tolerate, if the T is more than 4 cm, even if it's N1, I would prefer to give 2 cycles first.
Right. Dr. Bakshi, sir, one question to you is regarding the clinically evident N2 disease. You know, day by day, our role is going down in the induction chemotherapy until the surgeon tells us. But where you will rightly fit the role of induction chemotherapy?
So I think, Tejinder, these are multidisciplinary decisions, and as you mentioned, probably these are best taken in a MDT, and select the patients carefully, and take the opinion of the surgeon on whether they can remove it upfront. And in case if they, for N2 disease, if they are not able to resect it upfront, then give neoadjuvant 2 cycles and then evaluate them for surgery again.
Right, right. I think, to be very honest, there is no prospective randomized data to define the subset who will benefit from the surgery. There are many factors which people do consider, like what Priya said about the single station N2 disease. It was less than 3 centimeters prior to induction. Disease can be resected, or you can do a lobectomy rather than pneumonectomy. And I think one more important criteria is the response. Those people who are responding to induction, they are a subset where you can think of attempting a surgery, right, Priya? If I'm fine with whatever.
Yes.
And
yes,
there are some, so there is no, you know, proper subset to really define the which patient are going to benefit from the surgery. But there are certain contraindication, known contraindication, which we know about is the, you know, patient who have got a poor performance status, those who progress during the chemotherapy induction, those who have got a T4 disease, you know, multistation N2, and those who have got an extra capsular nodal extension. These are the subset, I think, which will not benefit from the surgery. Dr. Thongse, one more question to you is, where you will put the role of radiation, post-operative radiation, in this N2 disease? Dr. Thongse, is there?
Yes, I'm there. If there is margin positivity, consider for post-operative radiation therapy in N2 disease.
Hmm. Otherwise, you will not go for it, except for the margin positivity.
I guess, sir, if the N2 persists at the end of the final histopath, if the N2 comes positive in spite of giving induction, chemo, and then operating, then I think if it's a fit enough patient, patient should get chemo followed by radiation to take care of that N2 component.
Okay, okay. Dipali, any other thoughts you have? Yeah.
Yes. Hello.
Yeah, don't say, doctor, don't say. Bolo.
Yeah, if it's N2 disease positive, also, and margin positivity, these are the two indications to give post-operative radiation therapy after surgery.
Yes. Okay. That's what I.
I will put. I'll. Dipali, you tell me. So there are two subsets, what Priya and Dr. Thongse said. One is patient with surgical positive, margin positive, and second thing is N2 positive disease.
Yes, sir. For surgical margin positive disease, we have to add radiation. And for only if N2 margin negative, in that case, we can defer the radiation because toxicity will be more. For M3 disease, definitely there will be indication for radiation.
No. So N3, I am not talking about. N3 is totally a different subset. I'm telling a patient has undergone surgery and margin has come positive, you will give. That you are very clear about.
Yes.
Patient who has got a positive N2 at the time of surgery, you think there's a role of radiation?
Sir, since the toxicity will be more in that case, the chemotherapy will take care of this part. So we can avoid radiation use substance.
So Dipali is very thankful to us to send it to medical oncologist. Anyway, so what? It's a controversial area, you know, Priya, I think. There are some people who give, some people who do not give. But one thing is for sure, randomized trials have shown no clear benefit to think about giving radiation. There are some centers, you know, because these are the patients who have got a very high risk of recurrence because of multistation, subcarinal involvement, high nodal receptor involvement. So these are the patients where many centers they give. But honestly speaking, most of the people, they don't give any radiation because there's no randomized controlled trial which shows the benefit of giving radiation. That's the reason why, you know, the stage 3 disease is a disease which needs to be discussed in the multidisciplinary board also. Bhavin, any thoughts on it? Dr. Bhavin?
Yeah, I agree with what Dr. Dipali has said, and partially agree with what Dr. Thongse also said. Giving a post-operative radiation in a N2 disease anyway, giving a post-operative radiation in the lung leads to a lot of radiation pneumonitis. Anyway, if these patients are going to receive immunotherapy also after adjuvant immunotherapy after treatment, so that will lead to another immunotherapy induced pneumonitis. So that can lead to multiple types of side effects for the patient. So I would prefer not to give N2 post-operative radiation in N2 disease who are properly resected and margin R0 resected.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think these points we have already taken about the N0, N1, N2, and N3. N3 is an area where more of a non-surgical modality. N2 also we have thought about because this is the area. These are the N2 is one where we have to be, we have to have very strong ability to decide which way the next treatment will go ahead. This mediastinal strategy, Priya has already mentioned about the emerging role of EBUS in our practice, day by day practice. So I think we are a little bit this is a question for factors which surgeon decide on the operability. Priya, I think you have already evaluated.
Yes,
told
sir.
Us.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But already for mediastinoscopy, MRI, yeah. Brain.
So I think.
R0.
I agree with Priya about the MRI part. You know, MRI brain has to be. Dr. Bakshi, you are. I think MRI brain we are doing for stage 3 for every patient.
I think absolutely it has to be done because so many times it so happens that you will come across a patient who will have a small metastasis and that changes everything. So I think it's a must. PET CT, MRI, and as she mentioned, EBUS to stage the patient. So right, absolutely, sir. These are critical components of the management.
So this patient was given a chemotherapy with paclitaxel and carboplatin. And follow-up scan showed partial response to therapy. Later on, the case was discussed and the patient was planned for to go for chemo radiation with the weekly paclitaxel. And the patient tolerated the therapy very well. Now, there's a lot of thing which goes on about the concurrent and sequential. You know, Dipali, which one you will feel more better? You will go for sequential or you'll go for concurrent?
Concurrent.
Dr. Tonse, where you will put the sequential or you will not think that the sequential will really help us in the any area?
I would straight away go for concurrent chemo radiation, sir.
So everyone favors concurrent. So Bakshi sir, I think nowadays the chemo regimen which everyone follows is the Pacli Carbo, or you have started giving pemetrexed also?
So I think undoubtedly concurrent chemo radiation, there's no question about it. If you look at the trials, concurrent has been shown to have a better outcomes as compared to sequential. So I don't think so that's any area of controversy. As far as the choice of chemotherapy regimen is considered, I think most of us would individualize based on the patient factor. If the patient is young and fit, you can give cisplatin etoposide. If the patient is elderly or has comorbidities, then often we end up giving weekly paclicarbo or pemcarbo or vinorelbin cisplatin, those kind of regimens. In vinorelbin cisplatin, of course, in fit patients.
Right. So standard, ideally, like you said, is very right. The standard is cisplatin and etoposide. But, you know, we do go ahead with a more tolerable, I will say, a reasonable or tolerable approach of giving Pacli and Carbo. And also people do give pemetrexed and platinum and vinorelbin also. Vinorelbin, I think I have not used it for a long time, but it's still an acceptable alternative for this kind of patient. So this patient developed radiation pneumonitis, started on steroid, later on things. But you are giving radiation, right, sir, for every patient of stage 3?
Pardon? Can you repeat that question?
Consolidation. Do we still use consolidation after you finish the chemo radiation?
Consolidation chemotherapy you are talking about?
Yeah, consolidation chemotherapy.
No.
Okay.
Not for everyone. Yeah. So in fact, for some reason, if the patient is not able to go for immunotherapy, then only.
Okay. But my question is that if suppose you are using cisplatin etoposide, I am not so much in favor, but if you're using Pacli and Carbo, because the trial had shown that you should think about giving two more cycles, even though, you know, there are the benefit is not so great. with a paclicarbo, if suppose you are using paclicarbo, you give 2 cycles of consolidation? No.
No, I don't give.
Okay, fine.
First chemo radiation, then you move on to immunotherapy.
Okay, fine. Basically, I am using it only with the paclicarbo. If I am giving cisplatin plus carboplatin and pacli, I do give sometimes 2 cycles of in a physically fit patients of 2 cycles, even though the benefit is not, it has not shown so much benefit. So I think, sir, I think this is a question because we are looking at durvalumab, the PACIFIC study. How much, you know, we have been discussing so much about stage 3 disease, but honestly, what percentage of a patients are stage 3?
Actually, in practice, if
probably
you see
25.
Yeah, Dr. Kosa, you can.
Just 25% of them are stage 3.
Like, so you are the lucky person who will get 25%. So, Dr. Priya?
Maybe more. 35.
Yes, so there may be a referral bias also.
They will have a referral bias. They are the lucky people, potential candidate for durvalumab, right?
No, not only that. I think probably as radiation oncologists, they would get patients from 10 different medical oncologists.
Right.
So for individual medical oncologists to see that many number of stage 3, I think very few would be getting that.
Right. Priya, what is your percentage?
Sir, for stage 3?
Yeah.
Yeah, at least 30-35%. I mean, what we get at is always mostly stage 3. I mean, we get a lot of stage 3 actually, around maybe.
So Priya is getting 30%. So Priya is getting 30. Dr. Tom says that.
Yeah, we work at the same place.
We work together.
So that's the reason ACI why you gets... refer each one. Anyway.
Yeah.
So ACI will have the maximum utility of durvalumab. Anyway, we'll discuss about classes also there. So, Dr. Bakshi and myself, I think we are getting very less number of percentage, right, sir?
So it will depend. I think probably, like if you ask the same question to Tata Hospital people or ACI has stalwarts like Deshpande sir and Sanjay Sharma, sir, so obviously they are going to see more CA lung than the community medical oncologist.
So, right, that's the truth. So we have to start working with sir because then only we'll get durvalumab over there. Anyway, Bhavin, what is your, you get how many percentage nowadays, stage 3? You have never referred any stage 3 to me for a long time. That's why I'm asking. Dr. Bhavin, Dr. Dipali.
Yeah. Sir, I don't think I have seen more than 10 cases a year of stage 3.
So, more than 10 cases in a year, stage 3?
Less than 10.
Less than 10.
Definitely less than 10. Most of the lung cancer that we see is either stage 1, stage 2 inoperable for
NCRT
or metastatic disease for
palliative RT. Right. So, Dipali, what is your percentage?
Sir.
I think there is some connection issue with Dipali. So, Durvalumab, I think, how many percentage, Dipali?
Sir. 15-20%, sir.
Okay, great. So I am expecting 15-20% coming for the chemotherapy. Great. That's thank you. So the PACIFIC study basically looked at the role of durvalumab in this particular area because this was the first study which looked at the role of immunotherapy as a kind of maintenance post-treatment with CTRT. So we had most of the people, we considered them for the maintenance durvalumab. And the studies have shown very excellent result in this particular group of patients. And this drug is indicated and approved as a maintenance therapy for this particular subset who have not progressed on the platinum-based therapy. So I think, in this patient, we saw that the patient had received NACT prior to chemoradiation. So I think we have discussed this point, what are the reason prior, to, where you will go for induction chemotherapy prior to the chemoradiation. And these are the studies looking at the PFS post CTRT. So this is the first drug, first and only approved immunotherapy drug to show sustained and durable PFS benefit at 5 years. And you can see over here the 5-year OS data which has come up in the recent days, and it has shown efficacy across all the subgroup. So I think this ASPO update also has shown a very good important impression about the OS data will not go. Dr. Bakshi sir, I think I'm just asking how many patients you feel are eligible for stage 3, which you feel are eligible for the durvalumab also? Somewhere down the line, the usage is not so high. That's the reason I'm telling you.
So see, the what happens is that in India, there are so many factors. Even if you have a patient who's a candidate for durvalumab, probably may not afford it. Or there may be some comorbidities due to which actually you're not able to give. Autoimmune conditions would be there, which might prohibit use of immunotherapy. So ultimately, very few patients end up getting it. And I think the major barrier is the cost factor, I would say.
That's the truth, sir. So, but the counseling part, do you start before the starting the chemo radiation or after you have finished the chemo radiation?
No, we counsel the patient right up front. If the patient is means you know that he's a candidate, then you counsel them up front about the role of immunotherapy.
Yeah, even I agree that, you know, most of the patients which I counsel them, you have to counsel them prior to it. There's no point of counseling them after the radiation, chemo radiation is over, because you will be able to know who are going to it doesn't matter so much post CTRT the response also. So this patient was given durvalumab for a long time and you can see the response, a good therapeutic response you can see from here to here and continued for a long time, and this patient was started on durvalumab within 42 days after the end of radiation. And you can see the real life data also about placed durvalumab. Yeah, a very confirmed objective response. So 40% of patients were initiated on durvalumab after 42 days of the post CRT, and the response was similar to what the PACIFIC study showed over there. So this patient received 20 cycles of immunotherapy. And you can see a response, which this is ASCO update of 5-year OS data of 42.9%. So the key takeaway, I think, which we take it from this panel discussion is that, you know, MDT is the approach which gives the best outcome for this subset of patient, and concurrent chemo radiation gives better outcomes than RT alone or chemo alone. And role of near induction chemotherapy, we had discussed only in certain selected patient. And consolidation chemo doesn't improve outcome. That's very important. And durvalumab is the only approved immunotherapy to show 5-year OS and the PFS benefit. After a long time, we had something to show in the stage 3 where the outcome has been dismal to less than 15% overall survival. So durvalumab should be considered as an option for this particular patient who have not progressed on CTRT. And the counseling should start prior to chemo radiation. And this drug shows outcome, it improves the outcome in all subgroup irrespective of PD-L1 status or EGFR status. So thank you to all my panelists. Thank you for the excellent discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It was wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the excellent panel discussion.
Thank you, Suhas, for the invitation.
Thank you. Thank you all panelists. So now I would like to, for the next session, I would like to invite Dr. Bhushan Nemade, who is a senior consultant oncologist at Nav Sanjeevani Sankalp Hospital, Nashik. And he would be moderating a case-based panel discussion on optimal sequencing of ALK inhibitors in ALK-positive advanced NSCLC patients. Dr. Bhushan Nemade.
Yeah, thank you Suhas for such a nice words. So can I present my screen? I think someone is presenting. Can you just stop presenting?
Yes sir, I'm sharing your presentation.
Yeah. Okay. Good. So can you change the slide on your end, or shall I do it at my end? Okay. So I think all my panelists are there. I think Dr. Nilesh, Dr. Devendra, Dr. Vaibhav, and Dr. Rahul. Can you just confirm your presence?
Everyone? Yes, sir.
Yeah. Hi. Yeah.
Yeah, everyone is there. Okay. So just let's get started. So this is a 50-year-old Indian woman, no history of smoking, presented with severe left back pain, breathlessness, and cough since 3 months. HRCT was done and it showed solitary tumor in left lower lobe with moderate ipsilateral pleural effusion. Histopathology was suggestive of moderately differentiated adenomas CA. EGFR was wild type, non-mutated, and ALK was positive by IHC. PET-CT was advised, which shows lung CA, obviously, with pleural effusion and CNS and spinal mets. CNS, brain, only one mets. So final diagnosis was stage 4 NSCLC and ALK positive. So my question to Dr. Nilesh is that any other investigation you would like to do before starting any treatment, or you are okay with the investigation?
So if the ALK is positive, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. We can hear you.
So there will be several blood work and other tests, routine tests, which will be done. And I would always do a CEA, a CBC, a liver function test, as well as a baseline 2D echo for all my patients. Apart from that, for clinical decision making, I think most of the reports are available for this patient.
Okay, so single CNS mets is there. So Dr. Devendra, do you advise MRI for this patient, or you are okay with PET-CT showing confirming single brain lesion with spine met, single spine lesion?
Usually FDG PET-CT is not the optimal modality.
Not very good investigation.
Yeah, I would like to do MRI brain also along with PET-CT.
So what additional advantage you will feel this in this particular patient, the MRI will give us the...
Because now we know at baseline the patient has one brain met. And maybe like on MRI, the patient is having more lesions. We're going to start the treatment with the most likely with the CNS active TKI. So we have to see the response of TKI on this patient. So because we know that baseline some diseases there should have a full picture so that we can follow it up when we are using a CNS active TKI. That's it.
So basically, you will like to do MRI just for a response assessment purpose, because you should have a baseline MRI so that every time you see the response and you get it. So do you do MRI for decision of your choice of TKI? We'll go to in that detail, but just a yes or no. Do you do a MRI brain for ALK positive NSCLC to decide your what TKI to be used or not? Dr. Vaibhav, you can answer. Or
Dr. Vaibhav here. Actually, in my practice, I actually see the clinical effects of the brain mets if it is there. If patient is just too much symptomatic, then obviously we go for we'd do MRI to see the burden of the disease and whether to give WBRT or not. That is an option always. If patient is too much symptomatic, so, and then we go on to us.
So, for any particular opinion about choice of TKI, will you do MRI for that or not? You're okay with the single lesion? I would.
Sir, if single lesion is there is a brain mets, then obviously crizotinib is out. And as per the financial of the patient, serotonin or anything, you take the precedence.
Okay. So, Dr. Rahul, do you do NGS in this patient? There is already an ALK positivity by IHC. So, anyone for NGS, upfront NGS?
No, if upfront we have got an ALK positive by IHC and that too on a validated platform, then generally if not an urgency or if not required, I don't prefer NGS at this point of time. And I would prefer to start with an ALK TKI.
Okay.
But if given a choice upfront, then and if it's possible, then we always offer NGS to the patient. But here we already have a report.
Okay, let's suppose that this ALK is not positive by IHC. Patient is just came as the biopsy report, adenocarcinoma, acinar variety, young female patient, no non-smoker history. So what test, one direct panel you want to do or sequential panel you want to do?
No, generally then, if the history is typical, non-smoking female, acinar histology, adenocarcinoma, we know that there is a chance of having a mutation, most likely to be ALK mutation or even EGFR mutation as well. But given a choice, then if we can offer NGS upfront, it's always better. Nowadays, we also have a option of lung-targeted NGS also, limited NGS, which can cover all the mutations as well as other targeted mutations. So if it is possible, I always offer that. If there is any limitation, resource limitations, then at least EGFR, ALK by IHC and ROS1.
Dr. Nilesh, you will do complete panel or sequential? First do EGFR, then do ELK, or then do PDL, or just one go, you do whatever like you like. Lady,
so
like,
Dr. I complete
lung-based panel.
So I base my test pattern based on the urgency of a treatment decision required. Even now, an NGS takes easily up to 2 weeks. And in such situations, if I feel time is of essence, I prefer to do the EGFR, ALK and ROS in a shorter panel. Having said that, my indication for an NGS also would be to see for any co-mutations, even if I know that this patient has an ALK positive disease.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. And what is the percentage of ALK positivity? Yeah. Go ahead. Please go ahead.
No. Just wanted to just make a point. If there is an urgency, what we feel, then we always prefer to start on chemotherapy and then maybe wait for the mutations to come up. So in that case also, if NGS, as Dr. Nilesh sir already pointed out, that the advantage is to get to know the other variants also. So maybe given a choice, if the other resources are not a constraint, then NGS would be better. If it is an urgency, we can always start it on chemo and wait for the results.
So actually, the reason why I made that point specifically was because there is enough data to suggest that if it turns out to be ALK positive, then giving initially chemotherapy causes a lot of drug resistance and it is inferior.
Correct. And for this particular patient, the patient do not have any CNS type of symptoms. So whatever effusion and breathlessness and pain probably may be because of bone mets and pleural effusion. So I agree with Dr. Nilesh that at least for such a selected patient, we should always wait for ALK patient and do not start at least chemotherapy in those who are where you get more chances. So my question to Dr. Devendra, how much percentage you get your ALK positive patient, unselected population, unselected one. I'm talking about unselected. Yeah. Out of 100 patient you see lung.
Yeah, I do ALK test only in patient with adenocarcinoma, irrespective of smoking or non-smoking status. And literature as such says 5%, but my positivity is like around 2-3% only. I get 2-3%.
So you feel Indians are little less than what Japanese or other Asian or other?
Even Indian data has like given numbers more than 5 also. But somehow, like in my experience, the numbers are close to 3-4%, not more than that.
Okay. And for selected population, let's suppose a young female, non-smoker, what percentage you are expecting to be a positivity? Anyone? Dr. Weber, you can answer. For selected population, like this case.
Yeah, male or female, it doesn't matter when it comes to ALK actually. If they are non-smoker, they are young, if they have presented to brain mets, there is very high likelihood. Mind you, I have seen patients who have actually... They came up with me to me with brain mets and I just ordered ALK and I had a strong gut feeling here they will come positive. And I have hit the target, like 5 out of 5 of the patient have come ALK positive in last 1 year. So it's like that selected population, as you told, young non-smoker with upfront brain mets, CL lung. There have got
to be, I agree with you.
I'm really surprised that 2% is what the other doctor was saying. I think our rates are somewhere higher.
Selectively, if you're a female patient, non-smoker, males and females, like then rate is extremely high.
If you include cranial disease, then the incidence is somewhere maybe around.
This is very high.
It's still about
very high. Yeah. That's what I
have. But in unselected, I agree that it's not even 5%. There is a lot of difference in the data from Delhi because there they have seen up to 8% in many of the publications. But in my clinical practice, it has not crossed 5 in unselected patients.
Oh, okay. So let me ask Dr. Rahul once again, method you want to do for ALK, whether you trust FISH, you trust NGS, you trust ISC, which is your method of choice?
So as I said earlier, if NGS is ordered, then that is always preferred. If not, then routinely we do it by IHC, by Ventana platform. So nowadays we don't order FISH upfront. IHC by Ventana is validated and it's considered equivalent.
Any specific reason why not FISH? It is the first method which has detected ALK.
Yes. So initially FISH was, it's little cost effective also. IHC is cost effective and, maybe the time period can be less. So that's what it's preferred. Yeah. And it's proven to be equivalent.
I also think that IHC will pick up some patients who are FISH negative also.
And that is, and I this situation would be more relevant.
Yeah, so just to update you guys that ISC and NGS are concordance with each other and their specificity is 95% to 93%. However, fish can miss approximately 10% of ALK positivity if it is not being verified by NGS or this pattern. So you have to be very careful if you are ordering fish because we may miss some patient and we may lose those patients for not giving ALK inhibitors basically. Okay, so next slide, please. I think I have getting one SMS. My voice is low. So is that clear? I'm okay because panel.
No, I think you're quite clear. You're quite clear.
Yeah, you're quite clear. No, okay. So do you routinely do brain MRI before starting ALK therapy? This question is partially being answered. Anyone can answer basically. Devendra, you can go ahead. Do you do routinely MRI before starting any ALK therapy if patient is ALK positive?
For ALK positive, I do.
Yeah, for all patients.
Yeah.
Anyone disagrees in the panel or everyone agrees onto it?
I do it for every patient with lung cancer.
Yeah, we agree.
So I agree with Dr. Nilesh that I do it for every patient of lung cancer. Stage 3B onwards, I do it for every patient. So that is the way we should be doing it very commonly. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is what I'm trying to make because CNS mets many times is asymptomatic and whatever agent you use, whether you use alectinib, crizotinib, brigatinib or lorlatinib, we all know that patient with brain mets fare bad as compared to those who don't have brain mets. So these baseline brain mets have underperformed in many trial, whatever drug you use. So we should do MRI brain for all these patients. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so coming back to this, now we all know, we all talk about CNS and ALK positivity. We all know that crizotinib is not very good as far as CNS penetration is considered. Seritinib was thought to be better as compared to crizotinib as far as this patient, as far as the CNS penetration is considered. But what, any specific reason you feel that crizotinib is not working in CNS metastatic patients, or it is just a pharmacodynamic failure or pharmacokinetic failure? Like whether it is a sanctuary site and say crizotinib cannot cross blood-brain barrier, or any other reason you feel that's why these patients are not being responded to crizotinib. Dr. Nilesh, then everyone can answer.
So basically, crizotinib is the first generation ALK inhibitor, which has very limited activity against several ALK mutations, and plus it doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier and doesn't have good intracranial activity. So both of these factors are important.
Yes. We'll come that resistant pattern and mutational burden and drugs wise in the next few slides. But what point I wanted to make is that crizotinib do not have any or good CNS penetration, and the newer second line generation has better CNS penetration. Next slide, please. Okay. So these are the key factors which we all consider. Anyone follow any other things apart from the clinical evidence, efficacy in first line, CNS efficacy, long-term safety, resistant pattern, and after progression, later options availability. So we all follow this, and there are 5 approved drugs for this particular patient. So now the main important question, which drug will we choose? One by one, Dr. Nilesh, Dr. Devendra, Vaibhav, and Rahul. And we'll go to into discussion part at later slide, but just one answer, which drug you will prefer? Finance is not concern, patient can take any medicine. Dr. Nilesh, your choice for this particular patient.
So my choice for this patient would be alectinib in this situation.
Okay. Okay, any Devendra, Vaibhav, Rahul?
Yeah, lorlatinib is also
alectinib, everyone for it.
Yeah, is also a good option, but the biggest data, the longest follow up and OS data is available with alectinib. So although lorlatinib is prone to be more active, but the OS data is presently available with alectinib. So we are more comfortable in using alectinib in this setting.
Yeah, exactly.
If you are US, you have brigatinib also. You are in US, you have brigatinib, everything available, then what? You still, alectinib is your choice because of first drug and longer data, or you are impressed with good data of lorlatinib?
Sir, I totally agree that alectinib is the drug to go here, because there is data for lorlatinib following alectinib. If someone progressed on alectinib, I had my patient who had progressed on alectinib and then he did fared very well on lorlatinib, but you don't have a reverse data, right? Same is the case with Brigati.
Yes, we don't have a reverse data, correct.
Exactly.
Yes, we don't have a reverse data. Part, but the same answers can be like for Egypt. Yeah, Vaibhav, let's give a twisted question to you. It's same like osimertinib in first line. No? Why? Like osimertinib data is also there in second line, but we all love to use osimertinib as the first line. So you, why don't you do that way? Okay, let's get the lorlatinib as the first line or brigatinib as the first line. And probably we don't know whether alectinib will work or not.
But in really both, yes, I totally understand your point. The problem you hear is actually the in EGFR positive, there are very few drugs, I think, apart from osimertinib, very few drugs have CNS data. Osimertinib has got a very robust CNS data. So that works in favor of lorlatinib, osimertinib. But when you come to ALK positive, alectinib has got a very robust data for CNS mets as well. And those who have progressed on seretinib and they respond. I had a couple of patients and one of the patients actually did very well on that. So I am a bit biased to start with alectinib and then turn on, I have something to go to lorlatinib maybe. Because almost the cost is of therapy remains the same.
Yeah, so Dr. Nilesh, you agree with this approach?
There are a couple of ways of looking at this. Number one, it's the issue is about should you sequence or should you use the first drug first? And when I say first drug first, today there is US FDA approval for alectinib, brigatinib, as well as lorlatinib. Okay. So the sequencing approach does not work in ALK positive as opposed to EGFR. Because there is inferior data with upfront crizotinib followed by alectinib as compared to upfront alectinib. So that issue is sorted. The concept of sequencing with the first generation crizotinib in such a situation does not arise. There is an issue regarding alectinib versus brigatinib. There is absolutely no head-to-head comparison. But we must remember that all patients at some point in time are going to develop resistance. So it is always better to use a drug which has better activity against resistant clones in the later setting, like lorlatinib. And another reason for using alectinib or lorlatinib is because of the safety profile. Lorlatinib is not a very easily tolerable drug. There are a lot of issues and a lot of monitoring that is required. As opposed to that, these patients will require anywhere between 3 to 5 years of treatment. If cost is not an issue, my choice remains alectinib.
Alectinib. So everyone is for alectinib. Dr. Rahul, you can just pitch in one.
I completely agree with all the panelists here, and even my choice would be alectinib. At this point of time, though, we know that lorlatinib data is also very good, and especially with the CNS penetration. Yes. But what I want to say is that we just have to wait a little more for the PFS data to complete. And still, at this point of time, we know that alectinib has around 35 months of PFS, and after that, we can use lorlatinib. So till we get the final data, still at this point of time, I would also like to prefer alectinib.
Yeah, 100%. Even I agree with all my panelists. Dr. Nilesh tried to say that crizotinib followed by alectinib is now no more the better option, and sequencing probably may not work in ALK because we all know that if they progress in brain, they progress very rapidly. So your best drug should go first. So crizotinib or seretinib followed by alectinib may not be a proper choice. You should use alectinib. I will also personally use alectinib because of whatever everyone has said. The data is more matured. We don't know lorlatinib long-term median, what happens. But till whatever data lorlatinib has shown, it has probably the broadest spectrum, good CNS penetration, and probably good competitor to alectinib rather than brigatinib, actually. So next slide, please.
Even in those patients without brain metastasis, still alectinib.
Next slide. Just to update the audience, this is what everyone trying to say. These are the 5 approved drugs, basically. Crizo, Seri, Alectinib, Brigatinib, and Lorlatinib. And the important trials which got the approvals for crizotinib, the median PFS was 10.9 months. For seretinib, increases to it by 6 months to 16.6 months. Alectinib is 34.8. Brigatinib is 29.4. And obviously, lorlatinib data is not yet matured, and we really don't know. But this alectinib and brigatinib and lorlatinib probably will contain for next 3 to 5 years for the first line ALK positive treatment. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah, this is what the sequencing we all were discussing. Just to tell you that the this ALK is little different from EGFR. It doesn't give you that much time. So responses rate in second line ALK, any second line you use, they are not very good. So your base drug should go first. And the only drug which is probably has some efficacy because of its broad spectrum, because of its mutational sensitivity, is lorlatinib in ALK positive patient. So alectinib followed by lorlatinib probably may be the best bet currently what we have in our armamentarium. Next slide, please. Okay, this is, and it works in CNS meds. Without CNS meds, obviously, it also has very good CNS penetration. So irrespective of whether there are CNS metastasis or not, your choice should be alectinib as the first line treatment. Next slide. See, as the same, alectinib effectively protect against and treats the CNS metastasis. What is more important is it significantly delayed the time of development of new CNS meds as well as progression of existing CNS metastasis. So probably presence or absence of CNS meds may not be your driving factor, that if patient has CNS med, you give alectinib and do not have, you give crizotinib. Probably that may not happen. If finances are not an issue, you should always give the best drug, that is alectinib currently available. Next slide. Next, this is being already told. Next slide. Yeah, so survival data at the 5 year as compared to crizotinib, it is better with alectinib. So for 5 year survival of alectinib is 62.5% as opposed to crizotinib. So approximately absolute 17% improvement in survival rates. Next slide. Coming to the side effect profile. Oh, okay, one by one, we will start from Dr. Vaibhav. What is your experience of alectinib side effect versus crizotinib side effects? Dr. Nilesh brushed his little bit, but let's go into great detail that what you feel about the side effect of alectinib.
Actually, I given it in a couple of patients and I did not find any earth-shaking side effects. I might be lucky because whatever has been described, I find it easier to handle as compared to crizotinib. One of my female patients, she is 32-year-old lady. Unfortunately, she had ALK positive CA lung stage 4. I started on alectinib and she complained of weight gain after 3 months. And
weight gain? Oh, okay. Weight gain or edema? You are edema or weight gain?
No, weight gain. Proper weight gain.
Weight gain. Okay.
And,
okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I searched it, and obviously there was one side effect of weight gain. Obviously, we oncologists are not concerned about weight gain. We are more concerned about weight loss. Right. So okay. I somehow counseled her to exercise a bit, so do some dieting and all. She is a young lady and she has remarkable response to alectinib. Almost she has received complete response in 6 months. But these odd side effects do spring up, but then they are very easily manageable. I don't think it's an issue. It's a challenge to
what are the commonest side effects you see for alectinib in your practice? Or forget about whatever the insert says or whatever the data says. What side effects you are like troublesome of alectinib?
No, not at all. Not at all. It's a very good drug to handle. Very easy drug to handle actually. And to my experience,
you feel it is better than crizotinib as far as handling.
Obviously,
you feel it is better than crizotinib. Okay.
Yeah.
Nilesh, you also feel the same way, Dr. Nilesh?
So nausea, rash, loose motions, and some edema in a grade 1 or grade 2. I have not seen anything beyond this.
Okay.
So
you are very much comfortable using
it. Very comfortable.
Yeah. Okay. Dr. Devendra, you agree with the panel, or you feel like there are more side effects?
As compared to other TKIs like crizotinib, seretinib, and lorlatinib. It's fairly well tolerated drug, and the only side effects are like grade 1 or 2 GI side effects. So that are easily can be managed.
Yeah. One more important point I want to highlight in this particular discussion of safety is that please note that the median PFS of alectinib is 3 times more than crizotinib. Still, it is better tolerated. So if you see, in 10 months of median PFS, you get a lot of side effects. And with the 3 times of the PFS benefit, what alectinib is having, and we are probably getting the comparable or a little better toxicity profile, that itself tells that alectinib is better tolerated even in a longer duration of time. So next slide. Okay. So this we already discussed. So safety is not a concern. Tolerability is okay. How many times you feel that dose reduction is possible? Like you advise dose reduction temporary for 1 or 2 weeks, or you feel dose reduction, like you don't need require any dose reduction for alectinib. And what dose generally you start, or you titrate, or you start with higher dose and then reduce? Dr. Devendra, your opinion, then we'll go to Dr. Nilesh. And
I don't remember
what dose you prescribe
dose reduction in any of the patients. For temporary interruption is required initially when you start the treatment. For diarrhea, and then we restarted the same dose.
Okay.
Usually, dose reduction.
And what dose you? What dose you give? What dose standard. You start? You start with the standard dose.
Standard, yeah.
600. Okay. Standard. Nilesh, Dr. Nilesh.
600 mg BD. Not required dose reduction for any patient.
For any patient, even Dr. Rahul and Dr. Vaibhav, you are okay.
Yeah,
with
totally
this?
Agree.
Yeah.
600 mg BD.
So you don't feel like crizotinib usme dose kafi vary hota hai, approval dose then later dose, so you don't feel alectinib has that issue and you are okay with whatever 600 standard BD dose to be given to the patient. So next slide. Okay, now this patient, other approved first line treatment, just we'll brush it up for the audience. Next slide, skip, just go this slides little faster. Because this is just a crizotinib study which shows that better than chemotherapy, ceritinib better than chemotherapy. Next slide. And now, just wait for this slide. This is the study which, previous slide. Can you go to previous slide? We'll just brush about what lorlatinib is currently having. The previous slide, please. Yes. So this is the study which we are talking about, where ALK positive patients were randomized in 1:1 fashion to lorlatinib 100 mg QD and stratified according to the brain metastasis and ethnicity versus crizotinib. Next slide. Coming to the toxicity, because we all feel lorlatinib has little more toxicity as compared to alectinib. Do you feel lorlatinib has more toxicity than crizotinib also, or it is lesser than crizotinib? When you compare with crizotinib, how you fare about the toxicity of lorlatinib? Dr. Rahul?
Well, I had a limited experience of using lorlatinib. We had used it in only one patient till now. It was fairly okay. Well manageable, apart from the hypercholesterolemia, which happened, and it was managed on the lipid lowering agents. But apart from that, there was no major side effects as such with lorlatinib.
So you are not worried about loose motion? Do you feel lorlatinib causes, say, loose motions, or it has the different set of side effects?
It has some different set of side effects.
Like you said, hypercholesterolemia.
Yeah, in whatever one patient which we had given, we did not face any major problem as such in the terms of diarrhea.
Okay. Dr. Vaibhav?
Yeah, not at all.
Dr. Vaibhav, you are.
Yeah. Actually, I have used in one patient post alectinib progression, and that patient fared well for almost 1.5 years on lorlatinib. And
1.5 years. Find
1.5 years, yeah, post alectinib. Actually, that is a legendary patient.
Okay.
He first took crizotinib for a year, then ceritinib for a year, then alectinib for 2 years, and then lorlatinib for 1.5 years. He was a young chap, 25 years. But ultimately, after lorlatinib, he could not survive. But he did fare very well on all the 4 drugs. So he is a case study in himself. So I did not find any of the side effects. Maybe the patient was very tolerant. He was young. Not many issues were there.
Okay.
So, yeah, lorlatinib also is a good drug.
Dr. Nilesh, your views, have you used lorlatinib very quite oftenly or just a limited?
We use it in about 6 patients. So you gave a reference of talking about ceritinib. So, you know, when we use ceritinib at 750 milligrams of, after food, that was a very toxic dose with a lot of diarrhea, which was a dose.
Very toxic, really. Agreed.
With 450 mg, it's actually a very well tolerated drug. Having said that, lorlatinib, when you start at 100 mg, is difficult to tolerate beyond the second and third month for a lot of my patients. The main side effects which come with this are edema of the feet, which is quite irritating for most patients. Weight gain, which is significant, hypercholesterolemia, which has occurred in all 6 of my patients, and mood disturbances, irritability, depression, and drowsiness. So these are quite relevant side effects. Apart from one patient, all have required a dose reduction to 75 milligrams.
So you reduce dose to 75 milligrams, correct? And what grades were there? Like grade 3 onwards, these whatever side effects?
They were actually grade 2, but the edema was disturbing for the patients that I had decreased it out.
Okay, okay. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is the side effect profile which all the eminent panelists were talking about. So lorlatinib has little different set of side effects: hypercholesterolemia, hypertriglyceridemia, edema, which Dr. Nilesh was saying, as opposed to diarrhea, which was crizotinib main problem, nausea, vomiting. So it has different set of side effects. We need to watch for them, and it may not be as better tolerated like alectinib. So, and it is still not been approved as the first line treatment in India. Yeah, so currently we have alectinib, seritinib and crizotinib available in our armamentarium actually to be for the patient. Next slide. Okay, so this is just this is not a head-to-head comparison, just to study, just to give you an idea which may be the probably the better drug in first line. Dr. Rahul pointed out one very important thing, that's probably a CNS penetration of lorlatinib is little better as compared to the alectinib. You can see that in CNS efficacy pattern, and safety-wise, alectinib is little better as compared to lorlatinib. But obviously, these are not head-to-head comparison. Just to update you guys that this is what the current status of first-line ALK inhibitor currently the two big player. Next slide. Okay, so next. This is done. We already talked about sequencing. Preventive, we already talked about it. Next. So as we know, everyone creates mutation. So it is the tumor also creates mutation. Like if ALK positive gets mutated, now what is your, do you do NGS now? Once the, let's suppose this patient been started on alectinib, now progressed, CNS progression. Do you see where the progression is and how rapid the progression is? And do you see the resistant pattern or mutational pattern in second line before deciding your second line treatment? Dr. Nilesh, then we will go one by one. So this patient received alectinib, progressed CNS, only CNS progression.
So in CNS progression, I mean, you can only do a liquid biopsy to identify. So there are mutations like the G1202 mutation and other such mutations. But due to the limitations availability in the drugs, I have not actually pursued them. But there is data to suggest that you should do it, because lorlatinib is one drug which actually covers most of the mutations that are known in so far about ALK positive disease. So it should be done, recommended, but I have not been doing it routinely. Very often, because these are isolated CNS progressions, and it's difficult to obtain tissue, obviously.
Okay, Dr. Vaibhav, do you do routinely NGS on the progression of first line ALK? Actually not,
to be very honest. Ideally, it should be done. But I know if someone has progressed on seritinib or alectinib, then obviously there is only one drug to go. And these patients actually are so happy taking TKIs and being happy at home that they deny taking chemotherapy. Okay. So putting them on a PEM-carbo is a task. I have experienced that. So I actually don't do NGS. I straight away forward from alectinib, I go to lorlatinib.
Yeah. Okay, Rahul, one question. This patient only progressed on CNS, no other progression. Do you still feel that alectinib need to be continued? You can add local treatment. What is your opinion on that?
I would prefer to give local treatment and continue with alectinib.
You will not change the treatment.
For the systemic progression, and at that point of time, I would think of.
Let's suppose it is progression, systemic progression, lung one lesion. You still one lesion amenable to SBRT or bone mets, which is amenable to whatever local treatment.
So if you are going to plan a local treatment, then definitely at that point of time, I would prefer to continue the same agent and give the local treatment. If it is a proper multi-system involvement, then definitely.
No, it is like not multi-system. Let's suppose these are isolated meds which can be taken care by a local treatment. You will continue alectinib and give local treatment.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Dr. Nilesh, you agree with this approach or you will change?
I think Bhushan brought out a very good point. You know, these patients don't rapidly progress when they're on good TKI inhibitors. And what happens is you have one small lesion coming up here and there. And there is data definitely in EGFR-based therapies as well as in a retrospective study which included ALK and ROS also, which showed that treatment of oligometastasis by SBRT was shown to improve the overall survival. One big challenge in this in ALK-positive disease is because there are multiple CNS recurrences and you consider a lot of SBRTs again and again, you have a big differential in radionecrosis, which creates a challenge in sometimes understanding whether it is disease or whether it is radionecrosis. I have faced that in a couple of patients, and so I'm mentioning it. But if it is an oligoprogression, I prefer to continue the same line of treatment and add a local therapy, usually SBRT.
Yeah, Dr. Devendra, do you agree or you will change second line?
Here comes the role of mutation testing.
Yes.
So
you do it for all patients?
Yeah, it should be done, but I'm not doing. Okay. But in this setting, like in the setting of oligoprogression or maybe a little more than oligoprogression, if you are planning to continue the same TKI and you are giving some local ablative therapy, I think like we should be doing the mutation testing. And if we detect a mutation which is resistant to the ongoing TKI, then it should be changed rather than continuing the same TKI.
So you will do mutation, and if there is a resistant, you will change. Otherwise, you will continue doing local
treatment. If there is more than oligoprogression, then ideally it should be done. Okay. Ideally it should be done, and we should consider changing. Like if we detect a mutation which is like to which the drug which is ongoing is not sensitive.
Yeah, sure. Agreed. Next slide, please. Next. That is already being done. Okay, so this is what everyone is talking about. This is the sensitivity observed all across the various mutation that can occur with ALK resistance. So if you see on your right side, lorlatinib is sensitive to majority of the mutation, which Dr. Nilesh pointed out 2-3 times, that it is probably the more broad spectrum drug apart from all these 5 available options which we have for ALK treatment. So lorlatinib undoubtedly probably the choice of drug for second line treatment. So everyone agrees with this statement that second line you always use lorlatinib if there is no other contraindication for lorlatinib, correct?
So since you made the mention of talking about NGS, there are situations where you have MET amplification and you probably go back to crizotinib for that.
Crizotinib, correct. Do you do PD-L1 in now before this starting on lorlatinib? Like let's do PD-L1. What is happening there? Or you do feel this is the time where immunotherapy should be given? Or no?
Not really. Immunotherapy, even the ABCP regimen has performed poorly in this group of patients. And as much as possible, yes. I'd like to delay it as late as possible.
Okay, so you're talking about that IMPOWER 150 study, correct? Those who have given the treatment. But that has shown that irrespective of whatever mutation you have, whether EGFR, ALK, it is better as compared to, obviously, so it is better when
ALK
there is
was, no I don't think they that population included ALK.
ALK was there, but 5%. They were less than 5%, but obviously, they are not that much, obviously, because the study was meant for other purpose. They were having only less than 5% representation, but it worked in that area also. So nobody for immunotherapy in such setting, or nobody will do PD-L1. Anyone, Dr. Rahul, Vaibhav?
No, not at this point of time.
So I think in general, ALK-related tumors have a very low TMB and a lot of, they are very genetically, genomic stability is there. So immunotherapy doesn't have a strong role in that.
Okay, anyone for chemotherapy now? Which I are think, the patient where you do chemotherapy and not give lorlatinib? Second line? Any particular subset?
Rapidly,
whatever.
There are many financial subsets where I would do that. In fact,
no.
Between lines of therapy, patients often get chemotherapy because arranging these drugs is sometimes a task, especially brigatinib under the patient access program. But if you're asking me whether I would do it for any particular clinical subset?
Yes, clinical subset. Rapidly progressing non-CNS disease. Let's suppose I will give you an example. Rapidly progressing non-CNS disease.
I would probably, but I have not encountered that scenario so far in any patient with ALK positive disease.
Yeah, Vaibhav, what is your choice?
Actually, ALK positive disease responds wonderfully well, beautifully well to ALK inhibitors. So it's not a concept that you give chemotherapy or bevacizumab or anything like that for a faster response. If you have a drug like Lorla, they respond.
Yes. Okay. Very good. So fair enough. I think we'll just go to the summary slides. Next slide. Just keep 2-3 slides. Go to the summary slides. Okay. Next. Yeah, these are guidelines which we are already discussed, that alectinib followed by lorlatinib gives you the best one. This is the chemotherapy. Go next. Yeah, okay. So this is the summary. Alectinib has demonstrated the longest median PFS of any TKI. It effectively protects against and treats CNS metastasis, and it is probably currently the only TKI which has been demonstrated clinically meaningful benefit in overall survival as compared to crizotinib, apart from lorlatinib also. Next slide. Coming to the second line summary. Next slide. So clinical guidelines recommend treatment with second ALK TKI rather than posting a patient for chemotherapy. Currently, lorlatinib is an approved option in second line setting. There are a lot of ongoing studies with brigatinib in post alectinib setting. Multiple treatment options exist in subsequent. There are treatment options. So probably there will be more treatment options over the period of time. There are already a lot of research going on in such particular patients. So I thank my panelists. I think we are on time. We finished in time. I thank all my panelists. So, anyone want to make some comment?
I would like to have an answer for a real case scenario from the moderator as well as the panelists. So he was a 56 years old gentleman who was diagnosed with the metastatic NSCLC, right upper lobe lung mass, along with this nodal, right supraclavicular mediastinal nodes. And there was one left periventricular deposit. So, and this was ALK positive, was started, although counseled for the first line option, but did not afford for. So started with the seretinib at that time. He did well till December 2020, so almost 8 months. So when he developed bilateral cervical lymph node, more prominently on the supraclavicular node. So although PET did at the time, showed an excellent response everywhere, except these were the nodes that were progressed. Did a biopsy, it showed a tuberculosis. So at that time, he was started with the AKT. He continued, started responding. But ultimately, after a total of 1 year of starting the treatment, he developed the progression with the CNS thing. At that time,
okay.
The brain radiation was given. There were multiple brain lesions. WBRT was given. Although counseled again for the second line treatment, but since the patient could not afford, I continued the patient on the seretinib, and for 8 to 9 months, he responded well till now. But now he presented with sudden onset lower limb weakness, right more than left. And along with that, there is a loss of bladder bowel. Bowel sensation. So PET was done. PET showed a response everywhere except there is a focal hypermetabolic, there is a hypermetabolism in the spinal canal, not in the vertebra per se. Spinal canal at C6, D1 and D8 vertebra, which was a new finding. And it showed maybe a leptomeningeal carcinomatosis basically. And even the MRI was done, it showed a similar findings. So did a CSF also, CSF turn negative, cytology turn negative. So maybe my question, how we can approach and what will be our treatment options from here onwards?
Re-counsel patient for alectinib because there is a leptomeningeal involvement definitely, whatever case you are saying, in spite of this, because this patient already had intraventricular, you said periventricular.
Yes.
So there are very high chances that this patient is seedling malignant cells down the spine through leptomeningeal involvement. So preferably you can do alectinib, but if still not affording, I would obviously RT always can be given, but problem with this CNS involvement is you cannot give CSI. Intrathecal chemotherapy, I don't know how we can use it here, but I think Nilesh can add on. Nilesh, how will you do?
So I agree that you should consider alectinib, and if it is the concerns of cost, brigatinib is still available through Takeda on a compassionate patient basis. Takes 2 to 3 months to arrange it, but I have 3 patients on it on a compassionate use program. It's worth initiating that process.
Great.
Clinigen does it for you, so it can help. But apart from that, till then, you will have to consider using nothing short of alectinib, and you'll have to think about some local treatment. It may not be a CSI, but maybe you'll have to give local radiation to that area, and of course, steroids and supportive care.
Yeah. Yeah, local
RT
which
should be the first line.
Yeah.
Thank you, Suhas. I think thank you, panelist.
So I would like to thank Dr. Bhushan Nemade for the excellent panel discussion and all the panelists, Dr. Nilesh Lokeshwar, Dr. Devender Pal, Dr. Vaibhav Chaudhary, and Dr. Rahul Kulkarni. So at the end, I would again like to thank our sponsors from AstraZeneca, Roche, and the BMS. And I would like to thank our the speaker, Dr. Pritam Kataria, along with Dr. Tejinder Singh and Dr. Bhushan Nemade for the panel discussion, and all the panelists, Dr. Deshpande Saab, Dr. Sanjay Sharma Saab, Dr. Ashish Bakshi Saab, then Dr. P. Priya Ishpunyani, Dr. Bhavin, Dr. Deepali, and Dr. Mubina Tonse, along with all the panelists of the last panel discussion also. Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.